ಆತ್ಮೀಯ ಬಂಧುಗಳೇ, ಅಖಿಲ ಭಾರತ ವಕೀಲರ ಒಕ್ಕೂಟ ಐಲು ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ರಾಜ್ಯ ಸಮಿತಿ ಪ್ರಸ್ತುತಪಡಿಸುತ್ತಿರುವ ಅಂತರ್ಜಾಲ ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸ ತರಬೇತಿ ಕಾರ್ಯಾಗಾರ ಮುಖ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಎಪಿಪಿ ಮತ್ತು ಮುನ್ಸಿಪ್ ಪರೀಕ್ಷೆಯನ್ನು ತೆಗೆದುಕೊಂಡಿರತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಎಲ್ಲ ಈ ವಕೀಲ ಬಂಧುಗಳಿಗೆ ಈ ಒಂದು ಕೋವಿಡ್-19 ಪ್ಯಾಂಡಮಿಕ್ನ ಭಾಗವಾಗಿ ಎಲ್ಲ ವಕೀಲರು ರಾಷ್ಟ್ರಾದ್ಯಂತ ಮತ್ತು ವಿಶೇಷವಾಗಿ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ರಾಜ್ಯದಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವೆಲ್ಲರೂ ಏನು ಕೆಲಸವಿಲ್ಲದೆ ನ್ಯಾಯಾಲಯದ ಕಲಾಪಗಳಿಲ್ಲದೆ ಖಾಲಿ ಕೂತ್ಕೊಂಡಿರ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಒಂದು ಸಂದರ್ಭದಲ್ಲಿ ಅಖಿಲ ಭಾರತ ವಕೀಲರ ಒಕ್ಕೂಟ ಈ ಒಂದು ಸುಸಂದರ್ಭವನ್ನು ಆ ಎಲ್ಲ ವಕೀಲ ಸಮುದಾಯಕ್ಕೆ ನಾವು ಒಂದು ಸಂದೇಶವನ್ನು ಕಳಿಸಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಆಗಬೇಕು, ಈ ಸಮಯವನ್ನು ಸದುಪಯೋಗಪಡಿಸ್ಕೊಳ್ಳಿಕ್ಕೆ ಅನುಕೂಲ ಆಗಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನೋ ದೃಷ್ಟಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ನಾವು ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸವನ್ನು ನೀಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಈ ಒಂದು ಅಂತರ್ಜಾಲ ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸ ತರಬೇತಿ ಕಾರ್ಯಾಗಾರದ ಒಂದು ವೇದಿಕೆಯನ್ನು ಸಿದ್ಧಪಡಿಸಿಕೊಂಡು ಆ ಮೂಲಕ ಯುವ ವಕೀಲರಿಗೆ, ಪರೀಕ್ಷಾರ್ಥಿಗಳಿಗೆ ಹಾಗೂ ರಾಜ್ಯದ ಎಲ್ಲ ವಕೀಲ ಮಿತ್ರರಿಗೆ ಕಾನೂನಿನ ಅರಿವನ್ನು ಮೂಡಿಸುವಂಥದ್ದು, ಜ್ಞಾನವನ್ನು ಹೆಚ್ಚಿಸುವಂಥ ನಿಟ್ಟಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಈ ಒಂದು ವೇದಿಕೆಯ ಮೂಲಕ ಸಾಕಷ್ಟು ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸಗಳನ್ನು ಸಂಘಟಿಸ್ತಾ ಬಂದಿದ್ದೇವೆ. ಈ ಒಂದು ವೇದಿಕೆಯಿಂದ ಕಳೆದ ಮೇ 26ನೇ ತಾರೀಕಿನಿಂದ ಪ್ರಾರಂಭವಾದಂಥ ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸಗಳ ಕುರಿತು ಈಗಾಗಲೇ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ರಾಜ್ಯದ ಉಚ್ಚ ನ್ಯಾಯಾಲಯದ ಗೌರವಾನ್ವಿತ ಮುಖ್ಯ ನ್ಯಾಯಮೂರ್ತಿಗಳಿಂದ ಹಿಡಿದು ಎಲ್ಲ ಗೌರವಾನ್ವಿತ ನ್ಯಾಯಮೂರ್ತಿಗಳು ಹಾಗೂ ಜಿಲ್ಲೆಯ ಪ್ರಧಾನ ಜಿಲ್ಲಾ ವಸತಿ ನ್ಯಾಯಾಲಯದ ಗೌರವಾನ್ವಿತ ನ್ಯಾಯಾಧೀಶರು ಹಾಗೂ ಎಲ್ಲ ಹೆಚ್ಚುವರಿ ಜಿಲ್ಲಾ ಸತ್ರ ನ್ಯಾಯಾಧೀಶರು ಹಾಗೂ ಕಿರಿಯ ಮತ್ತು ಹಿರಿಯ ಶ್ರೇಣಿಯ ಎಲ್ಲ ಗೌರವಾನ್ವಿತ ನ್ಯಾಯಾಧೀಶರುಗಳು ಅಲ್ಲದೆ ಈ ಒಂದು ವೇದಿಕೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಪರಿಣಿತ ಹಿರಿಯ ವಕೀಲರುಗಳು ಹಾಗೂ ಪರಿಣಿತ ತಜ್ಞರುಗಳು ಸಾಕಷ್ಟು ವಿಷಯಗಳಿಗೆ ಸಂಬಂಧಪಟ್ಟಂತೆ ತಮ್ಮ ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸವನ್ನು, ತಮ್ಮ ಅನುಭವದ ಅಮೃತವನ್ನು ಈ ಒಂದು ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸ ವೇದಿಕೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ನಿರಂತರವಾಗಿ 102 ದಿನಗಳ ಕಾಲ ನೀಡ್ತಾ ಬಂದಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಆ ಎಲ್ಲ ಗೌರವಾನ್ವಿತರ ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸದ ಒಂದು ಧ್ವನಿಯ ಸುರುಳಿಯನ್ನು ವಿಡಿಯೋ ರೆಕಾರ್ಡಿಂಗನ್ನು ನಾವು ನಮ್ಮ ಐಲು ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಅನ್ನುವ ಯೂಟ್ಯೂಬ್ ಚಾನಲನ್ನು ಪ್ರಾರಂಭ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದೇವೆ. ಆ ಐಲು ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಯೂಟ್ಯೂಬ್ ಚಾನಲ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ನಿರಂತರವಾಗಿ ನಡೆದಂಥ 102 ದಿನಗಳ ವಿಡಿಯೋ ಚಿತ್ರೀಕರಣಗಳನ್ನು ಈ ಒಂದು ಯೂಟ್ಯೂಬ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಅಪ್ಲೋಡ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದೇವೆ. ಸಾಕಷ್ಟು ವಿಷಯಗಳಿಗೆ ಸಂಬಂಧಪಟ್ಟಂತಹ ಎಲ್ಲ ವಿಡಿಯೋಗಳು ಈ ಒಂದು ಐಲು ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಯೂಟ್ಯೂಬ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಲಭ್ಯವಿದ್ದು ತಾವು ಅದನ್ನು ವೀಕ್ಷಿಸಿ ಅದರಿಂದ ಹೆಚ್ಚಿನ ಜ್ಞಾನವನ್ನು ಪಡೆದುಕೊಳ್ಳಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಆಗ್ತದೆ. ಈ ಒಂದು ಯೂಟ್ಯೂಬ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಬಂದಿರತಕ್ಕಂಥ ವಿಡಿಯೋಗಳು ನಿಮಗೆ ಲೈಕ್ ಆದಲ್ಲಿ, ನಿಮಗೆ ಅದು ಮನಮುಟ್ಟುವ ರೀತಿಯಲ್ಲಿ ಇದ್ದಲ್ಲಿ, ನಿಮಗೆ ಅದು ಸಂತೃಪ್ತಿಯನ್ನು ನೀಡಿದಲ್ಲಿ ತಾವು ದಯವಿಟ್ಟು ಈ ಯೂಟ್ಯೂಬನ್ನು ಲೈಕ್ ಮಾಡಿ, ಶೇರ್ ಮಾಡಿ, ಹಾಗೇ ಸಬ್ಸ್ಕ್ರೈಬ್ ಆಗಿ ಇನ್ನೂ ಸಾಕಷ್ಟು ಹೆಚ್ಚಿನ ವಿಷಯಗಳನ್ನು ತಾವು ಪಡೆದುಕೊಳ್ಳಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಈ ಯೂಟ್ಯೂಬನ್ನು ಫಾಲೋ ಮಾಡಿ. ಧನ್ಯವಾದಗಳು. ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ.
ಮೈ ಕೊಲೀಗ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಫ್ರೆಂಡ್ಸ್, ಸ್ಟೂಡೆಂಟ್ಸ್, ದಿ ಲೆಕ್ಚರ್ ಟುಡೇ ಈಸ್ ಆನ್ ದಿ ಪಾರ್ಟ್ನರ್ಶಿಪ್ ಆಕ್ಟ್. ದಿ ಪಾರ್ಟ್ನರ್ಶಿಪ್ ಆಕ್ಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಗವರ್ನ್ಸ್ ಅ ಕಾಂಟ್ರಾಕ್ಟ್ ಬಿಟ್ವೀನ್ 2 or more persons ಹೂ ಜಾಯಿನ್ ಟುಗೆದರ್ ಟು ಡೂ ಬಿಸ್ನೆಸ್. ಒರಿಜಿನಲಿ Contract Act contained all the provisions, and thereafter in 1932 those provisions were removed from the Contract Act and a new act came, the Indian Partnership Act. We also have to keep in mind that wherever the Partnership Act is silent, the Contract Act will apply. The Contract Act will apply so long as its provisions are not contradictory to that of the Partnership Act. Now, the rules of contract, example, capacity to contract, offer, acceptance, are all applicable to partnership, except minors, which I will come to later. Now, for this lecture, there are 70 sections in the Partnership Act. I have tried to collect all judgments from 2017 to 2020 so that this lecture becomes relevant. I have found 300 judgments of all over the country and also some of the Supreme Court, ITAT, etc. And from there, I discovered that there are about only 25 sections which have regularly gone to court, which means these are litigated sections, which is of good importance to lawyers. I will give judgments in respect of these sections which are frequently litigated. Some sections I may have 4 judgments, some 2, some 6, some 7. I'll give you all the judgments. You can read it. Now, Section 4 of the Partnership Act says it is a relation between persons who have agreed to share the profits of business carried on by all of them or any one of them acting for all. Andre, there must be an agreement between two or more people. The motive must be to earn profit and share it. The agreement must be to carry out the business jointly or by any of them for all of them. Ivaga udaharanege, supposing A and B buy 100 tons of mango and they agree to sell it. This forms a partnership and A and B are considered partners. Supposing A and B buy 100 tons of mango and agreed to share the mango between the both of them, 50 tons, 50 tons, then it is not a partnership. They must join together for the purpose of doing business and for the purpose of making profit and sharing the profit. Now, as far as Section 4 is concerned, there are about 6 judgments, right from 2018 to 2020. I will go through them slowly. Please note them down if you are interested. First judgment, 2000, and all the judgments are SEC online. I may not say SEC online, but all judgments which I am citing are SEC online. First judgment, 2020, SEC online, Bombay, page 38. Second judgment, 2019, SEC online, Allahabad, 5623. Third judgment, 2019, Allahabad, 5623. Ella SEC online. 2018, Bombay, 17134. 2018, Calcutta, 4383. 2018, Bombay, 613. 2018, Madras, 1446. Now, these judgments will give you a picture of what Section 4 of the part means. Now, two or more people may form a partnership. Under the Partnership Act, there is no limit imposed on the number of people who can join to form a partnership. But we have one more enactment called the Companies Act of 2013. Under the Companies Act, the maximum number must not exceed 100 and the minimum number must not fall below 2. Now, under Section 464 of the Companies Act, if it exceeds the maximum number of 100, it will amount to an illegal association of persons. Now, again, the Companies Act also places one more restriction. Section 11 of the Companies Act says that the maximum number of partners, which is one which is formed to perform a banking business, shall not be more than 10 people. And for any other purpose, not more than 20 people. So we can take it that 2 to 20 is the acceptable range of the number of partners in a firm. Now, how is this partnership created? Partnership is created by an agreement between two people or more people who agree to carry on business, make profit and share the profits or pay up the losses. This is an agreement which creates a legal relationship. Therefore, it is necessary to have an agreement of partnership. Now, the partnership agreement becomes the foundation. Looking at it from the Partnership Act and the Contract Act, it appears that the partnership can either be written or oral. But as far as it is oral, I have my own doubts about the efficacy and the extent of liability. I will come to that a little later. Now, this partnership agreement, what should it contain? It should contain the names and addresses of the partners, the names and name and address of the firm, the nature of its business, the capital contributed by each partner, the profit and loss sharing ratio, where any capital is invested, loan is given, drawing is made, what is the interest payable, rights and duties and obligations of partners, settlement of accounts on the dissolution of the firm, salaries, commission payable to partners, what happens when a new partner comes in, what happens when a partner dies, how do I settle disputes between the partners, and anything else affecting the rights of the partners. These are clauses which are appropriately, correctly contained in an agreement of partnership. Now, there is one issue here. If you take the Partnership Act, you will see one thing. Partnership is not created by status. That is, a Hindu joint undivided family cannot be a partnership. Partnership is created by contract. The other important section here is Section 11. Section 11 says that notwithstanding anything contained in the Partnership Act, the partners can agree to a different set of circumstances provided it is within the framework. Now, what is this framework? There is the larger framework of the Contract Act, and inside that there is a smaller framework of the Partnership Act. I can go outside the Partnership Act, but I cannot really go outside the Contract Act. But that also does not appear to be so, because Section 27 of the Contract Act says I cannot have an agreement in restraint of trade. But under Section 11, when there is a dissolution or a retirement, it is permissible legally for one partner, for the remaining partners, to tell the retiring partner for 2 years, you cannot do any competing business. It is still a valid contract, notwithstanding Section 27 of the Contract Act. Now, this contract, this partnership is an agreement. One partner and another partner, both acting together, or anyone acting on behalf of the other for the benefit of both of them. There is what is called a mutual agency. This mutual agency is found in Section 13 of the Partnership Act. It exists between the partners. Each partner is the agent of the other. If A and B are partners, A is the principal, B is the agent. B is the principal, A is the agent. And each are bound by the acts of the others. Now, to understand this mutual agency created, there are two judgments. One is 2019 SEC Online Madras 22401. The second judgment is 2017 SEC Online Kerala 26476. 2017 Kerala 26476. Now, in the agreement, we have a clause saying that the profits shall be shared in the ratio 50-50, 30-70, whatever it is they decide. And if there is nothing mentioned about the losses are also borne in the same ratio as the profits. It is also possible that in a partnership deed, they can say profits are shared 50-50, but losses are shared 30-70. So this becomes important, but ultimately when the partnership ends or there is a liability, then each partner knows how much is liable to pay. The partnership itself has no legal existence. It is merely a name under which two or more persons carry on business for profit, for mutual benefit. The partners are jointly and severally liable to bear the debts of the firm. The liability is unlimited, which means that once the partners are jointly liable for the debts, they're liable. Once the partnership assets have been used to pay off the debts, they become personally liable. The liability is unlimited. Now, what are the kinds of partnership? One, you have a partnership at will, which means that there is no fixed period for which the partnership exists. According to Section 7 of the Partnership Act, two conditions need to be fulfilled to decide whether it's a partnership at will or not. One, there is no agreement about the determination of the partnership, that is the end of the partnership. There is no clause with regard to determination. That means when we normally, it's a partnership, this partnership is at will. We can dissolve the firm and get out of the partnership. Two, there can be a partnership for a fixed period. Two people can join together and say that from the 21st of August 2020 till the 20th of August 2021, we will do this business. We will do it together. We will make profit. We'll share the profits. That is for a particular time. Now, at the end of 1 year in a partnership for a fixed period, at the end of 1 year, supposing the partnership still continues, then it becomes automatically, by operation of law, a partnership at will. Then you have a particular partnership. Andre, two people enter into a partnership for trading in mangoes for the mango season. So you can mango, they will say from, say, 1st of February to 31st of July, we will enter into partnership for this purpose. So it's a partnership for a fixed period, and it's also a partnership for a particular purpose. This is provided for by Section 8. If a partnership for a particular purpose continues after the period and they start doing business in other areas, then it becomes a partnership at will. It becomes a general partnership. A general partnership is, now ABZ company, now another business martivi, jateg martivi, profits na hanchkondu hogtivi, general partnership. Now, as I said earlier, partnership arises from contract. Partnership does not arise from status. That is, a Hindu joint family, members of the Hindu joint family cannot be called partners. There is no contract. That is a status. The intention of the partners is essential. The partners can exercise all powers which is provided for under the Act. But there are certain, and if something is not provided, then we have to go back to Section 19 of the Act to say what are the implied authority of the partner, whether the partner is acting within that implied authority. But they cannot exercise it illegally or fraudulently. Supposing one partner enters into a contract on behalf of another partner without the consent of the other partners, then the question as to the validity of that contract arises. If all the other partners say, yes, we ratify this contract, then that contract becomes valid. Now, with the consent of the members, a partnership firm can become a partner in another firm. Now, in a partnership firm, each member is called a partner. Basically, there are six types of partners. You have an active or managing partner. That is the man who takes participation in the conduct of the business daily. Then you have the sleeping or dormant partner. He does not participate in the conduct of the business, but is bound by the conduct of all the other partners. 3, a nominal partner. He is a partner in the firm only by his name. In reality, he has no significant or real interest in the firm. Partner in profits only. The partner who agrees to share under the agreement only the profits but says no, I'm responsible for the liabilities. Then minor partner. A minor cannot be a partner under the Indian Contract Act, but under the Partnership Act, he can be admitted to the benefits of the partnership. That is, a minor can get the profits, but is not liable for the losses. Then there is one more partnership, which is called partnership by estoppel. A person is not a partner, but he has represented himself by his conduct to other persons, that is to the outside world, to be a partner. He cannot deny it afterwards. Even though he is not a partner technically, he becomes a partner by holding out or by estoppel. Now, this is where I had said earlier, partnership could be by written agreement or oral. Now, an oral partnership is a partnership caused, created by estoppel. Now, the problem arises is, as far as the external world is concerned, he is a partner, so the firm is liable. What about internally amongst the partners? He is not a partner. He is not entitled to profits or losses, but he still is a partner as far as the external world is concerned. One more thing with a partner by estoppel is, he is not a partner by agreement. Therefore, the partnership deed containing his name cannot be registered with the registrar of firms. Therefore, filing of suits, etc., with this person also as partner is not possible. Now, you come to section 11, which is important, which I have already said. The partnership deed can decide what each partner can do. One partner looks into sales every day, and everybody will take it that he is the person responsible for the sale. One partner can look after R&D, and each partner has his own right, but together they constitute the bundle of rights, and each is the agent of the other. Now, though Section 27 of the Contract Act says that an agreement in restraint of trade is void, but Section 11 of the, if you read Section 11, it becomes clear that Section 27 is overridden, because it says, subject to the provisions act, the mutual rights and duties will be determined by the contract, and such contract may be varied by consent of the parties. So therefore, I can enter into a contract saying that while you are a partner here, you cannot do similar business for now. And when you leave, you cannot do business for 2 years. Now we come to Section 12. This is the rights of the partners. Now, Section 12, if you see, is divided into 4 different subsections. First one is the right to participate. Every partner has a right to participate in the conduct of the business. A partner's right to participate in the business may be where only some of them participate in the business, or where the partnership deed itself says that, listen, you cannot go outside and solicit business. Ni naache odra jagala artiya business baradilla. You cannot do any sales anta helabodu. Then 12D, partners have a right to access the books of account of the firm. Once he dies, his legal heir has got a right to inspect the books of account. Partners have a right to be indemnified for decisions taken in the course of business. But such a decision should be taken only in the case of an urgency, and should be of such a nature that an ordinary prudent person will take such a decision. Only then this indemnity will come. Then a partner under 12C has a right to express his opinion. They have a right to participate in the decision making of the firm. they have a right to now capital kodtare firm ge duddu advance martare partners have a right to get interest on capital interest on loans but all this has to be set out in the document and then right to share in the profits and also the liability to bear the losses in the same proportion as is set out in the document. Now we come to section 14. This is section 14 deals with the property of the firm. The property of the firm is all the stock and business assets of the firm and all other properties brought into the firm for the purposes of the business of the firm and includes the goodwill of the firm. ಹಳೆ ಕಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಏನ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ರು ಐ ಥಿಂಕ್ ಪ್ರಯರ್ ಟು 1980 ಇರಬೇಕು ಒಬ್ರು ಪ್ರಾಪರ್ಟಿ ಇಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ರು ಹಿ ಯೂಸ್ ಟು ಬಿಕಮ್ ಅ ಪಾರ್ಟ್ನರ್ ದೆನ್ ಹಿ ಯೂಸ್ ಟು ರಿಸೈನ್ ರಿಟೈರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಗೋ ಅವೇ ಅಂಡ್ ದಿ ಫರ್ಮ್ ಯೂಸ್ ಟು ಬಿಕಮ್ ದಿ ಓನರ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಪ್ರಾಪರ್ಟಿ ಹೌ ಎವರ್ ದಿ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ಗವರ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಬ್ಲಾಕ್ಡ್ ದಟ್ ಅವೆನ್ಯೂ ಅಂಡ್ ಸೆಡ್ ದಟ್ ಯು ಬ್ರಿಂಗ್ ಇನ್ ಪ್ರಾಪರ್ಟಿ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟು ಪೇ ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಪ್ ಡ್ಯೂಟಿ ಆನ್ ದಟ್ ಪ್ರಾಪರ್ಟಿ ವಾಟ್ ಬಿ ಯೂಸ್ ಟು ಡೂ ಇನ್ 1978-79 ಇಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಪರ್ಮಿಸಬಲ್ ಎನಿಮೋರ್ For section 14, I have a few judgments. What is the property of the firm? There are many judgments. I'll give you a few. 2020, SCC Online, Delhi, 710. 2020, SCC Online, Delhi, 710. 2019, Madras. 9147. 2019 Kerala 3404. 2019 Madras 5425. 2019 Calcutta 73. 2017 Delhi 12196. 2017 Guwahati 1193. 2017 Calcutta 13063. Now, this is the property of the firm. Anything which is brought into the firm and it forms the asset, capital asset, etc., becomes the property of the firm. Now, how should the property of the firm be used? The property of the firm can be used only for the purposes of the business of the firm. Partners joint, if I get 100 tons of mango, that's the property of the firm. What should I do with it? I should take the 100 tons and sell it, make profit and divide the profit. For this, the utilization of the properties of the firm is covered by section 15. And for this, there is a judgment. 2017 SCC Online Calcutta 2017 Calcutta 13063. Now next what happens is if one of the partners derives any profit for himself from any transaction of the firm or from the use of the firm property or from use of the firm's connection, he is bound to account for that profit and pay it to the firm. He cannot keep it himself. If the partnership deed does not contain any restriction and a partner carries on business competing with that of the firm and makes profit, he should account to the firm for that profit and hand it over to the firm. For this section 16, there is one judgment. 2018 SCC Online Calcutta 7147. Then we come to 18, which says that every partner is the agent of the other partner for the purpose of the business of the firm. Then we come to one of the most important sections, which many of us tend to overlook, is section 19. Now, implied authority of a partner covers almost everything, and the authority as stated in the partnership agreement gives him the additional thing. But there are certain things which a partner, if there is no provision in the partnership deed, there are certain things which a partner cannot do. A partner has no authority to do certain things. That is, if you see, he cannot submit a dispute relating to the business of the firm. One partner cannot submit a dispute relating to the business of the firm to arbitration. He cannot open a banking account on behalf of the firm in his own name. Now, supposing the firm has filed a suit for recovery of money, he cannot compromise or relinquish any part of the claim made by the firm. Supposing the firm has filed a suit, a single partner cannot withdraw the suit or other proceeding filed on behalf of the firm. He cannot acquire immovable property on behalf of the firm. He cannot transfer immovable property belonging to the firm. He cannot enter into partnership on behalf of the firm. Now, section 19 of judgment, this is an important section. 2019 SEC Online, Bombay, 3920. 2019 SEC Online, Punjab and Haryana, 318, 318. 2019 SEC Online, Punjab and Haryana, 2140. 2018 SEC Online, Delhi, 8528. E judgments, you've noted there, you will get a clear picture of what a partner cannot do. The law says that if the agreement of partnership is silent, there is no custom or usage, then whatever is said in A to H of section 19, a single partner cannot do. Now, it is also possible that A to H is what the act says, partner cannot do. The number of things a partner cannot do can also be expanded. More items can be added by the partnership deed itself. Now, all this is said and done. Supposing there is an emergency, something has to be done. Even though the partner may not have expressed authority or implied authority, he can do such a thing provided it's an emergency. And secondly, that is what any other person of ordinary prudence would do in similar circumstances. Now, partners, I have a partner, I owe money to somebody. If my partner admits liability, and it's in the normal course of business of the firm, that admission of liability is binding on me. Supposing there is a managing partner who continuously does business, everybody knows Mr. So-and-so as the managing partner of the firm. Notice issued to him would amount to notice issued to everybody else, unless there is some fraud committed with the consent of the managing partner. Every partner is responsible and liable with the other partners jointly and severally for all acts of the firm done when he was a partner. Now, supposing there is a wrongful act which is done, or something which a partner should do but does not do in the ordinary course of business, the loss and injury is caused to a third party, then the firm is bound to compensate the third part, irrespective of what happens inside the partnership. Possibly then they can fix the liability amongst themselves and seek reimbursement. Now, I told you earlier that there is partnership by estoppel. This is where somebody holds himself out to be a partner. This proposition, before I go to that, I would just like to give you some more case law. That is, partners are liable jointly and severally at the section 25 helutade adukku ond ist case law ide 2020 scc online chhattisgarh 107 2019 scc online bombay 2234 2018 scc online delhi 8428 2017 scc online orissa Now I had already told you about partner by estoppel, that is where somebody holds himself out to be a partner, he will be treated as a partner. This is as far as third parties are concerned. It may not apply internally. 29 says, then, now supposing one partner transfers his interest in the firm to another person. Now, that other person to whom this his interest is transferred cannot interfere with the business of, in the conduct of the business of the firm. He cannot ask for books of account. He cannot ask to inspect the books of account. He is only entitled to receive a share of the profits of the transferring partner. And he will be bound by the accounts as prepared by the remaining partners. Now, if the firm is dissolved, what happens? Now, one partner transfers interest to a stranger. Thereafter, the firm is dissolved. Then what happens? The transferee, the person to whom it is transferred, ceases to be a partner, but he is entitled to proceed against the remaining partners for the balance of the, for any money which is due, a share of profits, etc. For this, there are two judgments, one judgment actually. 2017 SCC Online, Bombay 9413. Next, we come to an important provision which is at variance with the Contract Act. Minors. Minors being admitted to the benefit of the partnership is covered by Section 30 of the Contract Act. Now, a minor Section 30 says that the legal provision related, now a legal under the Contract Act, no person below the age of 18 can enter into a contract, which means that no minor can enter into a contract. But Section 30 states that the minor cannot be a partnership, cannot be a partner in a firm, but can be admitted to the benefit of the partnership. A minor will be entitled to get the benefits of a partnership firm, but will not be liable for any losses or other liability. The minor can be admitted into the partnership only with the consent of all the partners. Now, the minor would then therefore have a right to inspect the books of account, right to share the profits, right to sue partner for his share, but he is not liable for the thing. The minor, after he becomes a major, can elect to continue to become a partner as a full partner, profits and losses. The liability of the minor is limited. If a minor is declared as insolvent, his share will be kept in the possession of the official liquidator. If after attaining the age of 18 years, the minor decides to become a partner, then he has to give public notice within 6 months of attaining majority. If notice saying that, listen, I'm no longer interested in the partnership. If he does not give notice saying that, no, I'm not interested in becoming a partner, then he will become liable for all the acts of all the other partners until he gives such notice. When he becomes a part, when if after becoming a major, the minor chooses, elects to become a partner, he will be liable for all the acts of the partners to third parties. Once he chooses this, then he becomes a full-time partner and can take part in the conduct of the business. For this section 30, we have three judgments. 2017 SEC Online 11024. 2017 SEC Online Delhi 10500. That is 2017 SEC Online Delhi 10500. 2017 SEC Online Delhi 9508. Then we come to the next section. That is incoming partners. The consent of all the partners is necessary to induct, to take in a new partner. And so also a minor. Once a minor is decided to be taken into the partnership, then the minor admission to the partnership should be accepted by all the other partners of the firm. This is what section 31 says. We have one judgment here. 2018 SEC Online Kerala 3245. Now then, we next have retirement of a partner, section 32. A partner may retire with the consent of all the other partners. The partner may retire in a manner set out in the partnership deed. And supposing it is a partnership at will, by giving notice to the other partners, he can retire. Now, in a partnership at will, the deed may provide that in the event of any person retiring, the firm will not dissolve, or it may dissolve. So if one partner retires and the partnership deed says, no, the firm will not be dissolved, then the firm continues and one person goes out. Next, we come to section 32, which deals with retirement of partners. I'll just go through it in case somebody missed out. Retire partner can retire with the consent of the other partners. He can retire in terms of the special agreement which is contained in the deed of partnership. Where the partnership is at will, he can retire, provided the deed says that even if he retires, the partnership will go on. But that's why what happens is when you retire, you give public notice. So I retired from the firm. And that helps you because third persons dealing with the firm are not bound by your retirement unless it comes to public knowledge. Section 32 ge ondu nalak judgment ide. 2019 SEC Online Bombay 11471, 2019 SEC Online Bombay 11470, 2019 SEC Online Bombay 6646, 2019 Bombay 4645. Apparently, there is a lot of dispute in Bombay regarding this retirement of partners. There seems to be some case law there. Then we come to section 33 talks of insolvency of the partners. Supposing there are three, four partners. One of them is adjudged an insolvent.
he ceases to be a partner of the firm on the date when he is adjudged insolvent, whether or not the firm is dissolved. Now, supposing the partnership deed provides that no, even if somebody is adjudged insolvent, the firm will not get dissolved. Then the person who is adjudged insolvent will go out of the firm and the firm will continue. Now, if he is adjudged insolvent, the estate of that person is not liable for liabilities because he is adjudged an insolvent. Next issue is where one partner dies, then what happens? Where under the partnership deed, if the firm is not dissolved by the death of one of the partners, then and the firm continues, then the estate of the dead partner is not liable. But where on the death of a partner, the firm gets dissolved, then the estate of the deceased partner becomes liable for his portion of the debts. Next, we come to the right of the outgoing partner. Normally, under the Contract Act, Section 27, I cannot have an agreement in restraint of trade. But under the Partnership Act, when a person is going out of the firm, retiring from the firm, it is possible for me to place a restriction on him to say that for 2 years, you cannot do similar business, competing business, etc. And if he does business, I can sue him for damages, I can sue him for injunction, whatever it is, I can do that. Then, what happens? Man goes out, he starts making profit. He has to make good the profits he has made by the competing business. And the law says that I am entitled to 6% interest on such amount. Then we come to, there is one more thing which I want to stay this in. I have a partnership deed. Now I want to register the firm. What do I do? Then this whole thing is covered by sections 56 to 68 are important. 58 prakara, I should take my partnership deed and make an application to the registrar of firms, giving the details, firm's name, place of business, names of the branches, persons who are partners, when each joined the thing, etc., etc., etc. Then file it to the registrar of firms. The registrar of firms will scrutinize it and register it and enter it in the register. It is very important because merely making an application to the registrar is not sufficient. If you go to section 68, now this is, as lawyers, it is important because section 68, for me to prove that this is a registered partnership firm, I should take a certified copy of the extract of the register of firms and produce it before court. It is not sufficient if I just produce my application, registrar application, these are the partners, therefore I am a registered partnership firm, will not hold water. It is necessary to get a certified copy of the extract under section 68(2) and then produce it. Because between 56 and 68, every time there is a retirement, you have to intimate the registrar as per 58. Supposing there is a death, you have to intimate. Supposing there is reconstitution, you have to intimate. Supposing there is dissolution, you have to intimate. So all this has to be intimated to the registrar, and every time he will go on correcting his register. And therefore, an extract of the register as maintained by the registrar of firms is very essential. There are a few judgments in this regard. Section 58, that is making the application, is 2019 SCC online, Himachal Pradesh, 2897. Then 59, 2019 MP, 4391. Then we come to 63. 368 is important. 2017 SEC Online Gujarat 2406. These are important judgments for registration of firms and how as lawyers we should use the thing. And there is one more important. There is one more important thing. The name of the firm should not have the name Crown, Emperor, King, Royal, any other words implying the sanction of the government cannot be used in the name of the firm. And if that is used, the registrar of firms will reject it. Then going back, now, why is this registration important? Registration is important because of Section 69 of the Partnership Act. See, it is not compulsory for you to register a partnership firm. In India, it is not compulsory. There is no penalty. But non-registration leads to certain disabilities. What are these disabilities under 69, which makes it necessary for us to register? Now, if it is an unregistered firm, the firm cannot institute a suit. Two, in case of breach of contract by a third party, I cannot file a suit against the third party unless my firm is registered. No partners can claim a relief of set off. And the aggrieved person cannot sue the firm at all. Virtually no action can be brought against the firm. But there is an exception where the firm is dissolved. The partners can bring a suit for realization of the firm's properties. The 69 is a very vast section, which there are a lot of judgments because there are so many permutations and combinations in which lawyers have interpreted Section 69, saying that this applies in such circumstances, does not apply in such circumstances. I will give you a few judgments which, if you read, you will be able to distinguish the various. In this 1 hour upanyasa, it is not possible to get into those details. I'll give you those judgments. 2020 SEC Online Bombay 254, 2020 Bombay 233, 2020 Tripura 43, 2019 Allahabad 3780, 2019 Madras 17188. Then there is one Supreme Court judgment, 2019 4SCC 731. 2019 4SCC 731. Then we have 2019 Bombay 6880. One from Karnataka we have. 2019 Karnataka 2181. 2019 Guwahati 3489. Then I'll give you at random. 2018 Delhi 12960. 2018 Gujarat 3001. 2018 Kerala 1634. 2018 Calcutta 4252. Yeah, there are about, in fact, under Section 69, if anyone just cares to go, we have close to about 40, I have found 44 judgments under Section 69, various high courts, one or two by the Supreme Court. It takes a lot of time to go through all the judgments. You can do it in your leisure time, but basically you understand that if your firm is not registered, the firm can do nothing. Third party can sue you, but you cannot do anything. Now, we come to sections 36. That is, what is the liability of an outgoing partner? The outgoing partner cannot use the name of the firm. He cannot represent that he is partner of the firm. He cannot go to a customer and say, Barapa Nanjatege, ni firm but put Nanjatege baat helangilla. And if there is a restraint, he cannot enter into any competing business during that time. Then we come to what happens to subsequent profits after a person leaves the firm. Where a person leaves the firm and the existing partners continue the business without settling the accounts of the outgoing partner. Because if they don't settle his account when he goes out, then he is entitled to a share of the profits from the firm which he left, from the date he left till the date accounts are settled. On top of that, he is also entitled to interest at 6%. Now, this is section 37. There are some interesting judgments on this. 2020 SEC Online Madras 1095, 2019 Madras 9147, 2019 Bombay 6833, 2018 Kerala 5029, and there's one Supreme Court judgment which is 2017 16 SEC, 2017 16 SEC 331. Clear, right? 2017 16 SEC 331. Munnora Muatund. Now, sections 39 to 44 deal with dissolution of the firm. Now, circumstances arise when a firm gets dissolved. There are various modes for dissolution of the firm. One is, it's a partnership at will. I am retiring from the partnership. The deed says if one person retires, the partnership gets dissolved. Then partnership for a particular period, particular purpose. After that, they don't carry on business. The firm stands dissolved. Then there are two partners. There's an expulsion and then... Now, what happens? What are the liabilities of the partners in different situations? First of all, partners are liable for the act of the firm until they are given public notice. Public notice is given. But this does not apply to a partner who has been declared insolvent, who has retired, man who dies, or a person who is a dormant partner, nobody knows he was a partner. Then for section 45, we have some judgments. 2018 Gujarat 3542. Then 2018 Gujarat again, 2018 Gujarat 3562. Next is the winding up of business post dissolution. Dissolution aadmele, the business has to be wound up. When the firm is dissolved, every partner has a right to apply for the firm's property in the payment of debts and liabilities, and then the surplus distributed amongst them. The partners have mutual rights and obligations till such time as the firm is completely wound up. So once there is dissolution taken place, every partner has a right that the assets and incomings, whatever of the firm, should be applied for the liabilities. ಮತ್ತೆ ಏನಾದರೂ ಬಾಕಿ ಇದ್ರೆ ತಗೋಬಹುದು ಅಂತ. ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಒಂದು ಮೂರು ಜಜ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಇದೆ ನೋಡಿ. 2019 SCC Online Bombay 745, 2019 Guwahati 5614, 2017 Online Calcutta 13306. Now, partnership has been dissolved and accounts need to be settled. Various modes can be used for settlement of accounts. If there is deficiency in capital or loss is incurred when it is paid out of profits, if the profit is not sufficient or no profit is earned, then first profits in the kotputta liabilities. Profits are not enough, no profit is made, then out of the capital contributed by the partners, the liabilities are repaid. If that also is not enough, then it comes to the partners individually. In the ratio in which they have decided under their agreement, the liability has to be distributed. Now, what about repayment to third parties? So once this is done, then we come to, what do we say, 49. So, section 48 on the Helaburthini. I got some judgments on 48. 48 is mode of settlement of accounts between the partners. As I said, losses, deficiency of capital, ink kodabekunta. Adike judgments nodi. 2019 Guwahati 5614. 2018 Gujarat 1334. 2017 Kerala 21737. 2017 Rajasthan 3053. 2017 Delhi 10263. If you will notice, I kept all the judgments from 2017 to 2020. At least you will have latest judgments. And these are about 300 judgments in all in the Partnership Act. Maybe there are a few more, but these are all that I could locate. And most of it I've been trying to give to you. Some of them which are decided by the ITAT and all that, NCLT, ITAT, I have omitted. I've given you only what is decided by the courts. Because I can't apparently take an ITAT judgment and go to a civil court and say, this is what is the law. Then, what happens for personal profit after the dissolution of the firm? Sections 50 and 53. When the firm is dissolved by the death of a partner and business is carried on by the existing partners or his legal heirs, then they have to account for the personal benefit earned before winding up. It's very simple. Death aadmele, if there's a partnership is dissolved but accounts are not settled, till such time as you wind up the company, you have to account for the profits. Section 53 says that if there is no contract, the partners can restrain the other partners from carrying on similar activities. Now, firm dissolve aagtide. Innu wind up aagirodilla. But there are some partners carrying on identical business. Other partners business until the firm is fully wound up. Otherwise, there is no contract saying that I can't carry on competing business. But then this was the firm where we were all carrying on business. Firm is dissolved. It's not yet wound up. Till such time as it wound up, you cannot carry on business. And so now injunction thagobodu. That is the purport of section 53. 2019 SCC Online Calcutta 6006. 2019 SCC Calcutta 6006. Then we come to section 55. 55 deals with the sale of the goodwill. 55 sale of the goodwill ge there is one judgment 2019 Bombay 1747 ee section 55 nalli deals with the sale of the goodwill now somebody who buys the goodwill now what happens the existing partner can carry on business competing with that of the person who has bought the goodwill but cannot use the now I bought a firm xyz goodwill kota firm name tagontini an existing partner of the firm whose goodwill has been sold can do competing business but can't use the firm's name he cannot say that I am representing that firm in all the business he cannot go and ask for the clients of that firm the goodwill of which has been sold because apparently it is the name which carried money and the money has been paid there is no question of him again doing business under the same name then we come to section 50 agreement see then 56 to 68 I have done 69 I have done then I'll come to one other aspect more or less the partnership deed act is concerned now we have a new concept which is known as the limited liability partnership the limited liability partnership is an alternate the limited liability partnership is an alternate corporate business vehicle which provides the benefit of limited liability but allows its members the flexibility of organizing their internal structure just like a partnership on a mutually arrived agreement on the one hand you have partnership act and the other hand you have the companies act in between these two you have the limited liability partnership this means that entrepreneurs can form a limited liability partnership to provide services of any kind and form commercially efficient vehicles suited for whatever they are doing one may want to do distribution of food one may want to do Uber business something you can do it as an LLP see the limited liability partnership is envisaged to be a corporate distinct from a joint stock company under the Companies Act as well as a partnership firm under the Partnership Act now we have the Limited Liability Partnership Act of 2008 which provides the benefit now a partnership has no legal entity but is the name under which the partners carry on business but in a limited liability partnership ABC LLP it is a distinct legal entity added to that it is not constrained by the Companies Act it has got organizational flexibility there are no cumbersome disclosure requirements form 32 file maado form 1 file maado register of charges file maado enen illa now in a traditional partnership firm every partner is liable jointly with the other partners and also alone in his individual capacity under the LLP structure liability of a partner in a limited liability partnership is limited to his agreed contribution if I agree that my contribution will be 10 lakhs my liability is limited to 10 lakhs no partner is liable on account of unauthorized or independent acts of the other partners in an LLP therefore by this every partner is protected is shielded from the other partners against his misconducts or wrong deeds now there are differences in the administration of the provisions of the partnership act in various states as the enforcement of the act is at a state level filings registration changes etc however the rules for LLP are created by the central government hence there is now if you take partnership act the registration and certain rules will be different in Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, Kerala, etc. In a limited liability partnership, it comes from the central government. There is uniformity of rules throughout the Union of India. A partnership is not a legal person, but an LLP is a body corporate, having a separate legal existence. And just like a company, the liabilities of the LLP will be met from the extent of contribution agreed to be given by a partner and the assets and etc. of the firm. There is no unlimited liability. With this, I think I have more or less completed the Partnership Act in the constraints of time. It will take much longer to go into each section, but this is it.